thank you for Christian experience. Thou dost guide and bless thy people. Lord, what thou dost discipline us and train us according to our need. We thank thee for hard experiences that have taught us so much and brought us at times through fires of affliction. We praise and thank thee for the deep things of God which we have come to taste and know and understand. We thank thee, O Lord, for all thy gracious dealings with us and for that infusion of joy and peace in the Lord. Bless us this day, we pray. O Lord, we love thee and we desire to serve thee better and to please thee more. Strengthen us and help us all. Take us, O Lord, we dedicate ourselves afresh to thee for this coming week. And we ask, O Lord, that it may be a week of blessing. We ask that no matter what the circumstances may hold, we may face and deal with them as thy children ought to do, and prove thee and all thy mighty power. Lord, help us. Keep us much in prayer. Keep us close to thy side. Keep us dependent upon thee. Rid us, O Lord, of this ever-cloying pride in ourselves, and help us, O Lord, to be those who honour thee and put thee first in all things. Bless every family, every parent with great wisdom. Hear and answer, O Lord, we beseech thee, prayers for loved ones and those who have wandered from the fold and rebelled against thee, as we did for so many years. O Lord, we pray that thou wilt bring them back and that thou wilt bless them. Look upon us all. Thou knowest, O Lord, our weaknesses and our foolish tendencies. Grant us strength. Grant us determination. Grant us great sympathy for the lost around us. Grant us all an effective testimony. Open up, we pray, O Lord, opportunities before us, and help us that our lives may in no way discredit our words. Help us, O Lord, and bless young and old alike. Bless us with discernment and wisdom and judgment. But above all, O Lord, may we know that thou art near us. May we experience continual answers to our urgent prayers. Lord, come and attend us and help us. Bless, we beseech thee, every gathering that is convened, every effort that is put forth by this fellowship to make known Christ in our neighbourhood and farther beyond. Oh Lord, bless and help by the power of the Spirit, and may we see great things and all thy kindness expressed in the conversion of needy souls. Bless the young assembled even now for instruction. Bless them, O Lord, and open their hearts to thy truth. Bless the hundreds of teenagers and younger children that gather in this place and at our branch Sunday schools this afternoon. Mightily bless them. Draw them in again in large numbers. Bless all those who proclaim thy glorious word to them. Grant, O God, a work in hearts by the power of the Spirit, that teenagers and young children may have their eyes opened and their souls moved. O Lord, come and show Christ and save souls and work, we pray. Bless us when we gather for our evangelistic service this evening. Grant that many may be in this place who are yet outside thy kingdom, and touch their hearts and convict them and draw them in. O Lord, we pray that thou wilt bless Sunday schools and churches throughout this city and this land this day. And while this Lord's day shall run, O Lord, move in hearts wherever thy word is proclaimed in sincerity and truth. Bless the messengers of Calvary. Bless thy word. Deal with needy souls. Lord, what bring in days of awakening, we pray, that may stand and shake. an atonement for their sin, but to offer up his infinite, perfect righteousness to deserve heaven for them all. He came to suffer, and to suffer humiliation and the terrible, terrible agony of his death on Calvary, with an invisible suffering in his soul, suffering separation from the Father for us, and suffering an eternal weight of punishment for us. Which thing is true in him, says John? He was the man of love. If we are his, and we belong to him, and we have something of him imparted to us at conversion, and we follow him and desire him and go to him, then we should be very concerned about our love. same experience, to have been humbled, to have been convicted, to have been made ashamed of our inner selves and our outward conduct. We've been through the same experience of realizing what Christ in his mighty love has done for needy souls, and things we never saw before dawned upon us. We've come to bow the knee, to repent, understand this, or you'll miss the whole point. Verse 9, he that saith he is in the light and hateth his brother, now you're foolish, you will say, oh, I don't hate my brother, so this doesn't apply to me, and you'll miss the whole point. Oh, but you do, don't forget, John writes in black and white, he means everything in that family of hate. When he uses the word hate, he refers to a whole spectrum of hate, not just extreme hate, and you have to understand it. Coolness, like cool towards a brother and sister. That's all compounded under this word hate. It's the way John works. Are you indifferent to anyone? Are you detached? Do you have disrespect? Or, well, God forbid, do you have no need of any brothers and sisters? You have no need of fellowship. That's a terrible symptom of pride, to have no need. Do you have no obligation? You feel no debt, no obligation. You are unapproachable. You avoid people. Remember the beautiful story that is told in Spurgeon's autobiography of how when he was first converted and full of the joys of the Lord, he approached a portly brother in the church where he was, who was about 40 years of age, and he addressed him as brother. Now in those Victorian times, the portly brother of 40 was rather shocked to be approached by a youth and addressed as brother. He should have been addressed as sir, he thought, you see, and all the rest of it. And he was very cool, and his armour went up at once, and somewhat unapproachable and resistant. Then he found himself being chastised by this precocious scum convert for his coolness and so on. And he realised the youngster was right and that he was wrong. And that started quite a unique lifelong friendship between these two unlikely compatriots. And they were forever in touch with each other after that, though living in different places, and their lives took them in very different spheres. But so with us, are we stiff? Are we unapproachable? Are we self-protective? Are we jealous of others? Do we have a critical spirit, always ready to see the fault? Is there any racial distinction? Any class distinction? Any educational distinction? Any age distinction? Well, John compounds it all under one word, hate. Don't forget, when John works, writes, that's how he works. Black and white terms. He's only got two terms, hate and love, in this passage. Hate is one spectrum, love is another. So we must get the true sense. He that saith he is in the light, I believe in Christ, I love the Lord, and has anything other than warmth and approachability and helpfulness and prayerfulness for a brother and friendliness, is in darkness even until now. Now, I'm not wholly sure what the apostle means by his use of the term darkness. He obviously means it could be you're unsaved. So such a stiff, cold, no need, no desire for fellowship, no feeling of oneness, no bond with fellow believers. But I rather think he also means you could be terribly backslidden. There's not much light operating in your life. You're still walking in darkness. I don't think he means to say you're definitely unsaved. I think his darkness here is an elastic term. You're walking as though you were unsaved. Not in light. It's the Lord is in this context of Christian fellowship. The consequences of opting out, I'm sorry, the apostle returns to the negative in verse 11. He that hateth his brother, including, I'm sure, coolness, disdain, no sense of need, is in darkness. He wants us to be clear, either unsaved or very backslidden. And walketh in darkness. Well, what does that mean? Well, you plunder about. If there's no light at all, not even a chink of light coming through a door from the light in the hallway or the passage to give you some bearing, none at all. As dark as a dark room, you stumble about. You can't get your bearings. He that deprives himself of Christian fellowship or resists it walketh in darkness. Just think of that for 5 or 10 minutes. Now he knoweth not whither he goeth. You lose purpose. You lose direction. I am a Christian. I want to be full of purpose. I want to always have in mind I'm going to a heavenly hereafter. I'm serving the Lord. I'm pleasing Him. I'm praying to Him. I'm seeking souls for Him. I'm lost. I lose my way. The world, anything will draw me aside. I can't see where I'm going all of a sudden. I'm like someone in a blindfold. You mean Christian fellowship is that important? Is that helpful? Is that significant? Is that essential? Yes. These powerful illustrations are meant to tell us this. Without it, we're blindfolded in a darkened room, and we lose our purpose, our resolution, our determination, our sense of where we are, our perspective, so that our troubles seem 1,000 times greater than they should seem, and so on. Now I know why I feel so bad sometimes. Because I haven't loved the fellowship of the Lord's house and the Lord's people and made my contribution and sought to be part of it as I should be. This is rightly the very first theme that the Apostle John visits in this first letter of John. He knoweth not whither he goeth, because that darkness hath blinded his eyes. Dear friends, how much we need each other. How much we need the example of the Lord. How helpful we would be to each other if this were just part of our regular prayer. Lord, make me a member of my fellowship, worthy of that fellowship, helpful to others. How many people should I have helped who I haven't even noticed in this past week or month or year? Oh, dear friends, the Lord will bless us so richly if we take His words seriously. And so many of you do. But there are some in our congregation